Bits und Bäume und arbeitet im Konzeptwerk Neue Ökonomie e.V. und die kennen
Welcome to the translation for the talk. Degrowth is coming. Be ready to repair. The speakers are Anja Höfner and Nicola Gunu, and your interpreters are Waffle, Pascalina, and Pharmafirma. And we'd be very grateful for feedback on Twitter using the hashtag C3T or tweet at C3Lingo. Or send an email to hello@c3lingo.org. Hi, welcome. Great to see so many of you here. We've been introduced, but we'd like to introduce ourselves. I'm Anja, and this is Nicola. And both of us work for the Konzeptwerk New Economy. It's an association in Leipzig that deals in question of degrowth, post-growth, and social transformation. Our talk has the title Degrowth is Coming, Be Ready to Repair. And degrowth criticizes the current paradigm of economic growth and does this from several perspectives. And we want to transfer this to the process of digitization today and see how that might work. And in the second part, we're not only going to be talking of criticism, but also of alternatives. And Nicola is going to show some approaches that might work for digital technology. We sometimes talk of digitization in this talk, and we want to explain what we mean by that. It's the process of digital data production and transformation that covers ever more areas of our lives. And as you can see, there are several areas where that happens. This is a huge factor in our work or in work in general where things are digitized. It affects us on an individual level and in the area of interpersonal communication. It affects how we can conduct social co-determination by tools that are being used. And it has huge influence on the environment. We talked about this and it enters our collective conscience more and more, but this is something we'll be talking about today. And around these areas, we have broken promises or not yet fulfilled promises of digitization, starting with the area of environment. Digital technology promises to dematerialize processes so that we need fewer resources to design processes. Another promise is that digital applications simplify our lives and enhance our comfort. We no longer have to plan a route on a map beforehand. We can simply start walking and there's a device that tells us exactly which way we have to go without having to think about it. A third promise that maybe belongs to the area of co-determination is a rapprochement. The internet initially wanted wanted to simplify communication between all humans in the world on the same level, and that still exists, but there's a concentration of power and a commercialization of the internet. And a fourth promise is that automatization liberates us of work and of that it automates production. These are images that exist in the public sphere, and there are two dystopias or utopias, whichever way you want to describe it or understand it. Between which these future visions of digitization exist. So it's a spectrum between digital capitalism on the one hand, or surveillance capitalism maybe, and on the other hand, fully automated luxury communism, where we no longer have to do anything ourselves, where we have all the time in the world and where machines do the work for us. Both of these are problematic because, well, surveillance capitalism is very problematic for our democracy and our civil rights, but both of these only work with a large destruction of the environment and a large overuse of resources. So both of these promise material well-being, but it's questionable whether or not we can get there with digital technology, because we've already reached a point where we've exceeded some planetary boundaries, and many people have understood that we're in the midst of a climate crisis where material well-being is no longer possible to the extent that we have it in the global north, and it won't be possible in future. And this is where degrowth comes into play. It criticizes degrowth, as I mentioned initially, because many criticizes this paradigm of growth and gives us alternatives beyond growth for a freer and more self-determined life in future, where we can maybe achieve global fairness and have more time in our lives. And I would like to explain what degrowth is. It stands for a transformation path towards forms of economic activity and social self-organization in which the well-being of all is at the center and the ecological foundations of life are preserved. This includes a fundamental change in everyday practice in dealing with one another and a comprehensive cultural change, as well as overcoming the capitalist mode of production with its growth, competition, and profit constraints. So this definition shows several points. Most importantly, the keeping of the ecological foundation of life and overcoming of the capitalist mode of production. This degrowth movement started in the 70s, where the decroissance movement in France first showed up. It has a snail icon, and an important point in that was the report of the Club of Rome. The important thing, or the special thing about degrowth, is that it's not solely a scientific discourse, but also it's both a scientific and a social discourse. It has strong social relations. Since 2008, there are international degrowth conferences where the community meets. It started in Paris with 140 participants, and 2014 we had the first degrowth conference in the German-speaking countries with 3,000 participants, and it refreshed this movement that was critical of power, and it enlivened it, especially in the German-speaking countries. As I wanted to mention, it's not simply a criticism of the existing system, but also wants to create concrete visions. It's this there exists this term of concrete utopias, where we try to establish strategic models and ways of a social togetherness in future, and that enables a good life for everyone.
So there are different streams in DeGrowth. So it is a term for the different streams. I will expand on this later. So there are different forms of criticisms, like feminism. There is a strong, sufficient-oriented stream.
So
there is a researcher who works a lot on. So DeGrowth and
eher der internationale Begriff und Postwachstum wird eher halt im deutschsprachigen Raum benutzt und schließt aber auch diese internationale
Postgrowth is used in the German speaking regions, but it also includes the DeGrowths and like the décroissance in France or décrochita in Italy. And the critics was with the critics in this movement. They all have in common that it is an economic ecological critics. They say our system, the economical system, is wrong. And there are I will explain now five different forms of critics. Based on this example of economic growth and of digitalization, that's not all of them, it's just a part of them. The ecological critics is fundamental and is important. The general critics about economic growth is that it destroys the foundations of life, so we cannot have endless economic growth on a finite planet. There is no second planet. This would be nice, of course, but we don't have one. And in digitalization, this means we sometimes think that we could do a lot with the technical growth. By having better technologies, we need less resources and solve the problem as that. But unfortunately, this does not work. I will say more about this later, because we need more many resources alone to make all these digital devices that we use in our everyday life, and it also uses energy to produce them. This graph shows which elements are used for electronic devices, and the ones which are marked in color are the ones which are for instance, conflict materials in red. Rare earths are the ones in greens, and in yellow we have other substances which could pose a threat. So resources and energy are finite, and some people might think, oh, we have renewable energies, they are basically infinite, but no, this isn't the case. There's a limited sun supply, it only shines a few hours a day, we have finite amount of wind, etc. The periodic table gives us a nice leads to the next topic, which is the north-south critics. We it's a critic of the existing system on a north-south basis, because it says the economic growth in the northern countries is should be similar to the ones in the south, because the at the moment the south is used for as a cheap source of materials and workers, and this is also the same for the manufacturing process of digital goods. So we have extraction which is not good for the environment in the south of the southern hemisphere, and this also happened in other places, for instance in Germany in the Erzgebirge, and this always leads to the destruction of the environment, like and the extraction of materials is hazardous for the workers too. It poses a risk for the workers. So this is a double problem, not only ecological but also a social problem. When looking at the other side, the production, not the production, but the discarding of what happens with the waste, then this also usually or often ends in the global south. The biggest production countries of waste, countries which produce the most waste per person, are in the north, of course. We produce about 4,500 times the weight of the Eiffel Tower as e-waste, and with much of them we don't know where it goes, because recycling is not everywhere done very well. There are also other aspects when using in the utilization, which is discussed as a digital divide. We see that in the north we have many more, so the graph shows devices with internet connection in 2014. It might have changed a bit, but we still see that there is an inequilibrium between the north and the south. So we have inequality between the north and the south, not only with the production and the discarding, but also with the usage of devices.
A third critique is the feminism critique, also on the growth, economical growth. They say that that the economical growth, as it is now, is based on labor that is mostly done by women and connoted with women, and growth is connoted with the idea that wage labor has to be done, and that it's mostly done in the background, and the growth is profiting of this wage labor, and it is creating ever more of this. So if we look at digital technologies, also here there are logics of production and of which reproduce this inequalities between women and men, and also because software development is still a field dominated by men, so stereotypes and are reproduced in software, which are out of date, But due to existing data sets and because there is a person behind each code, these stereotypes are reproduced. In 2014, in Germany, not even a fifth of the people working in digital technologies have been women. So you can see here big inequality. And also in digital services, like for example in platforms such as Helpling, so there's an offlay of jobs who have beforehand been paid, such as for example cleaning services.
Produktionsarbeiten abnehmen und das ist aber letztendlich ja nur eine Auslagerung und
Prekarisierung, weil es auch mit dieser offlay to our services and say become more precarious because they are no longer in a fixed work contract. So a fourth stream of critique is capitalism critique. So the main point here is that growth is based on capitalism production and accumulation, so it cannot be regarded, so it cannot be considered or comprehended without taking this point into consideration. So if we look at digital capitalism, we also see here a big concentration on of power and monopolization. So diversity also on the internet is shrinking over time, and one of the most visited site that is not a commercial one is Wikipedia. And an accumulation and concentration is not only on the capital, but also on the data. So we have an accumulation of data. There is also that idea that data are the new petrol. So digital capitalism reproduces inequalities and exploitation. Instead of alleviating them. So the last stream of critique I will present is the cultural critique, which considers accumulation and alienation.
Und damit auch selber so Wachstumstreibern werden, also immer mehr oder immer
people have to be ever more productive and ever more ever faster. And digital technologies are forcing an alienation between work the workplace and are forcing an approachment of workplace and free time so that the both of them become one, such as for example when home office is being done.
Das ist auch herausfordernd. Diese Informationen muss man erstmal alle verarbeiten. Und das war so Teil dieser
part of the feminism critique is how the workforce
dass sich diese Steigerungslogiken auf immer mehr Lebensbereiche übertragen, wie jetzt zum Beispiel bei diesem Beispiel mit der
Helpling. Well, we saw that in this example of the Helpling platform, where areas of life that previously were not coupled to profit are suddenly turning into profit-oriented areas.
Ja, warum?
Why does that happen?
Gibt es so ein
why oder warum is growth running away, and why can digitization as it's happening today contribute to a different way? There are several mechanisms that I want to explain. There are three of them. The first is the rebound effect, then there's decoupling and network effects. And I want to explain what these are and how they work, because it's good to know that for an analysis. many of you have probably heard of the rebound effect. It's an increase in efficiency that's brought about by a technology or a device and leads to less energy being used. But the energy that's being saved isn't actually being saved. It is instead replaced by an increase in consumption, and we may end up consuming even more. And these rebound effects exist on several levels. They're direct, indirect, or macroeconomic. Direct effect is an increase in demand for the same good. So let's say I have a lamp that needs far less light, far less power to burn for the same amount of time. I might leave it on for longer time because I'm apparently saving energy. So it creates an increase in demand for the same good. Indirect effects is, for example, me saving money. With a car that uses less fuel, and I can use that money to consume something else, for example, fly on vacation. And macroeconomic effects are effects that happen by one person saving energy, which is then still on the market as additional supply, which drives down price and stimulates demand, and somebody else ends up consuming that resource. And this happens a lot with digital technology because we have a constant increase in efficiency. Computation gets ever cheaper, and yet we compute ever more. Streaming is another great example. We no longer have to drive somewhere to get a DVD. There's less input required from us to reach our goal of watching a movie, and this means that we consume more. The second mechanism that I want to explain is decoupling. Decoupling is the idea that the economy continues to grow without an increase in the consumption of resources. There's a relative and absolute decoupling, that's not very important, but digitization is often combined with a contribution to dematerialization. But people tend to forget that the material basis behind all these devices, there is no cloud, just other people's computers. There is no digital service without a material infrastructure behind it. And thirdly, there's the network effect. It explains how the use we get from one product changes when the number of consumers increases. So if I have a telephone, I don't get a lot of use out of it if there's only one other person who owns a telephone. But if there are three people, I can call a lot more people. And if lots and lots of people have a telephone, then I have the highest use for my telephone. It's obvious that platforms, digital platforms, exhibit this effect. A platform is more successful the more users it has. That's why monopolies are able to develop, digital monopolies such as Amazon or Facebook or WhatsApp. The more people use it, the higher use I get out of it. But this is not solely positive because it leads to monopolies and makes it difficult for alternatives to appear. I can't simply start my own social network because I need a certain number of users before it becomes attractive. So there's a fairly high initial cost. And maybe there are alternatives despite this blockade, and this is what Nico is going to show you now.
Thank you, Anya. We continue. We are now at the point where we saw and heard what is the state of current state. It doesn't look that good. We have some problems. We see that we can see that we are driving towards a cliff, which probably everybody knows. This is a known graphics. It's a years between the 19th century, and we see the temperatures in the years, and we see that high temperatures are becoming more often, so this somehow the Earth is getting warmer, obviously. We have the problem that, this is a problem, and we stand in front of a contradiction. On one side, for economic reason, we would like to solve the economic growth, and which would be good for from an economic and maybe social perspective, but on the other hand, we need to solve the foundation for our life, and this is our two goals, which are the two different goals. And we have a problem with the term of progress. So when talking about progress, what should this mean? Should it mean more production? Should it mean more efficiency? Then we can continue going into this direction. So that is this is current state where we could say, okay, we have to go degrowth one day or another, at latest when resources are exhausted, for instance oil or rare earth materials, coal already began. And we go into a direction where there is obviously no more future to go do this long term. This leads to big problems, because what will happen when we have these problems? Then it may be too late. Another way is to forebring the idea of degrowth, to make a decision that we want to degrowth before this, before we have run out of resources. It's a decision which would be more rational. It's also more rational than most decisions in capitalism, which are only profit-based, and it would be a really important decision. This means we need to reorganize our entire life and economy. And there, in this example, we see the idea, instead of, in the example of mobility, we could still try to save our cars, faster cars, more cars, or new technology cars, but we could also take a completely other technology, for instance the bicycle, which is a lot more sustainable. But this is more complicated for digital technology, so we need to evaluate different criteria and tools on how to solve this. The question about criteria leads to us having to decide on how we want to proceed, how we want to do degrowth. And in the degrowth movement, we usually discuss about how a good life for everyone would look like. I always like this picture. This is on a climate camp. It looks very well, but maybe this is not the utopia for everyone, not the way everybody would like to have. So this question about a good life for everyone really depends on taste of everyone, and it has to have to provide a certain liberty. But we also have to see it should be a good life for all, not a really nice life for some of us, which we currently have in the north. And this is, of course, a difficult thing, because we need more other principles. And one of these principles is the sufficiency, which means I don't mean always more and more. I don't need an own car. I could maybe share it. But this needs an active decision that my life should not have a negative impact on others' lives. It's not an individual question, it's a question of how to do the entire economy and the entire life. Considering digital goods and digital tools, this also has an influence. So maybe we should do something, a deceleration of our digital life. It's very good to. Yeah, so currently we need a big infrastructure, but we have a nice real-time communication, but maybe we could also have a less powerful infrastructure, which allows less fast communication. For instance, email, they are still quite fast. It would be nice to have to read less emails per day. And also less data retention is a good keyword, so produce less data, store less data, so use less resources to save data. And it's also a good idea from a privacy point of view, of course. So we could discuss everyone, what is a good life for everyone, how do we get there? Because maybe some people will be afraid of this because they can't do everything again that they have now. Some people would maybe like to do certain things, but it's not possible anymore. So the answer would be to have a dialogue. Everybody would have to see what would be right for his or her life, and which parts are maybe not needed anymore. So we need to see. Everybody needs to see that this is a question of, everyone has the right of it. So we need to redistribute goods in our system.
So this has to mean that those that are more wealthy at the moment, they will have less, but this also means that those that are poor at the moment will have more. So it's a question of fairness and a question of sharing. So one thinks that this should work very easily with digital goods, but here it is very important to take into consideration the economic costs, because there's always this question of the material, of the infrastructure and the raw materials. So we have to decide what should be shared and how, and to what cost. So sharing is a very complicated question. So we can also look at our everyday life and how we use technology. So maybe this technology can help us make this decision, how to share, how to live. So a very important aspect is repairing and longevity of things. So that the things we use, that they may be kept up for longer than a few weeks or years. And now we can ask ourselves, was that easier or better before? So it was mainly different before. So to repair things meant to have to use fewer resources. So and also the tools were easier to use back then. There wasn't an update for your hammer. And there was no problems with things that weren't usable after an update anymore. So today we have more complicated tools, more complicated technologies, which make it more complicated to repair and to use over a long time. So in regarding to repairing things, it's important to think hardware and software as one. And if software is no longer updated, is it still usable? And the hardware it is on is no longer usable as well. So the one idea of repairing it might be to write your own software for it, even if it's no longer officially supported. So it's important to take into account both of these aspects. So modularity is a very important aspect of this. You know this in software, but it's also for repairing a very important concept. So it's very different from what we nowadays know about smartphones. And it's very important that we try to fit the software and hardware to our needs. So there's also a question of standards. So if we want to repair things, we need to know how does the technology work. So hardware has to be more open source. But there are also complicated questions following this. So questions of transparency, questions of privacy, which data should be transparent, which data should not. My private data should not be transparent, but maybe the data of big companies should be. So there's that question of standardization. It's important, and it's also important because standards are needed to resolve complex problems such as longevity of usage of software and hardware, so that the economical costs are reduced or lessened. An important point is which technology are we using, and is that high-tech technology very cutting edge? That's nice, but there's also other forms of technology that are very interesting, such as low-tech or old-tech. So there are many tools we use, but we don't use them anymore because there's no software anymore. But there are people like hackers who take old tools and look at these and try to use them again. to continue using these resources that so you probably so it's known. And you have to decide what do we want. Do we want new features or do we want things that are longevity that have longevity? So this is a point where you also have to look at software and hardware together. You cannot consider them separately. So this question of what is the technology has also a very is also a very important point, the question of who is using it, who is developing it. So Anja talked about the feminism critic. So this is an important point. So for who develops software and hardware and for whom is it developed? How do we how can we share this technology? So we are now nearing the end. So we brought some literature tips with us. So if you want to inform yourselves on degrowth, so there's an introductory book, the first one, which is also interesting, and the points that Nico brought up is the second one. It's called Repairing the World. You can download it also from. So another book is a collection from 2016. It's a bit older. And there's also a book which summarizes and describes the different streams in the degrowth movement. And now. Now we talked about many points like modularity, longevity. So these are also what we asked on the Bits and Bäume conference, where we were also represented. And there are 11 demands and propositions, what do we need, what do we want to have digital technologies to procure a more vision that is better in the future. So we also have an assembly and we are in the About Future cluster in the CCL. You're welcome to join us there to discuss. And please continue to repair instead of construct new things. Thank you for coming. Thank you for your attention. And now we have some time for questions.
And you've been listening to Waffle, Pharmafirma and Pascaline translating for you. If you have any feedback, we'd be very grateful to receive an email from you, hello@c3lingo.org, or you can also tweet at us at c3lingo or use the hashtag c3t. And we have time for questions and answers now, and we're going to start with microphone number 3.
Hello, thank you for the lecture. I have one question about the slow communication, because somehow this is not that intuitive for me. I mean, if we transmit less information, this makes somehow sense to me. By, for instance, not transmitting too many megabytes of data, but having slower communication, for instance, not having instant chat or telephony anymore. They don't use much data. They are, yeah. How do you see this, or did I understand it wrong?
I think it's a question of balance. It's hard to determine beforehand what we're going to do with the resources that we have and will have in the future. But data volume is a large question. But I'm very interested in this idea of slowness, where there was a talk yesterday of a person speaking about regions in India where some villages don't have any access to the internet. And so somebody rode their motorbike through these villages, collected emails from everyone, and then passed them on. That was an interesting example of creating your own infrastructure. This slows down communication, but maybe it's easier.
Thank you. Let's continue at microphone 2, please. I like all your ideas. And our company, this would probably be unsuccessful because it is not cost efficient. So my question is, how could we make this more appealing to people, to companies? How can we sell it?
It's always a bit complicated. It's a large step, but if a company were operated by a collective, where people working for the company are allowed to determine, then they might be happy to work less and produce less. And it would be nice to have these criteria instead of this growth paradigm. And of course, the question is, how do we get to this point? Can we say that this practice is not sustainable, but at some point raised the large question of changing priorities? I understand that this is difficult, but it remains true that we have to deal with this. There is a clear path composed of small steps that get us there, and we have to reimagine.
You said that we have to resign from things, and I think this is true, yes. Not only because of the problems you described in the first part. I'm ready to resign to things, but how can I be sure that this really has an impact and it's not somebody else uses more?
In the degrowth introductory book, there are strategies of how we can get there, because of course it's one thing to have ideas, but then we also have to secure these concepts for a long term and to ensure that these aren't consumed by capitalism again. That's an important step. I lost my thread a bit here. We'll find it together.
How can I be sure that my resignal really has an impact?
We already have this today. I mean, it relieves my conscience when I consume responsibly, but of course I want to be sure that this doesn't stimulate more consumption in society. And of course, network effects may lead to renewed monopolies. That's why open interfaces are a request of this Bits and Bäume movement, because that would mean that it doesn't matter if I'm on Facebook, I could use Facebook to communicate with somebody who uses Twitter or Mastodon. So having these interfaces would be one approach against this concentration of power. Thank you. Microphone 2.
Hello, and thank you for your talk and for to have this topic in a bigger audience here. Last year I was at the Bits and Bäume conference, and I thought this thought was sounded quite free. Invited for people. How's this thought being continued now?
There are no ideas that I know of to organize a large conference, but we decided to liberate this name and say that everybody who wants and to create a non-commercial conference is welcome to do that. So if you know people from different parts of this spectrum, then do it. And there are some continuations. For example, there was a one-day conference in May in Dresden this year, which dealt with questions of renewability. There are mailing lists, there are associations, there are forums where these topics are being discussed, and I think there's even a group in the CCC that tries to bring these topics onto the agenda, but it's unsure how the large conference is going to develop. But of course we want it to continue, but it's a question of capacity as well. Allow me to say that Anja also worked for a book on this topic, so the connection between bits and trees, and you can even download it as a PDF from the publishing house.
Next question. Is there a kind of company consulting where companies could hire people who are still into this topic or already into this topic?
The Institute for Ecological Economical Research did a study of this where they they wrote portraits of societies that companies that don't want to grow any further. Premium Cola is another example of a company that says we do what we want to do and we're not planning to expand. This is interesting because these are examples that might be cool for you to see maybe their strategies of arguing. And I know of one other person who works on this topic, and come see me after the talk. Thank you to Anja Höfner and Nicolas Guenot, and give